Thank you, Chris. When I finished business school in 2000, I was a total idealist, convinced that business could change the world for the better, and I could make that happen. So I joined BP, which made sense at the time, because the company was run by John Brown. Brown had just become the first head of a major energy company to acknowledge that climate change was real and urge action. I fell in love with that company. I worked in Indonesia, in China, with colleagues around the world, consulting with local communities, working with human rights and environmental groups. I worked on projects where even the most hard-nosed engineers understood how important human rights and community concerns were to the success of the business. I loved big oil. And then, on April 20th, 2010, the Deepwater Horizon rig exploded in the Gulf of Mexico, killing 11 men and wreaking havoc around the Gulf and beyond. I had left the company 2 years earlier, but I watched in horror as this very different BP emerged in the press and in the hearings, one that was callous and reckless. It was the opposite of the BP that I thought I knew so well. So how could this happen in a company that, in my experience, went above and beyond what was required by law anywhere to protect people and protect the environment? Did my 9 years of work make any difference at all? To try to answer those questions, I started talking to people I'd gotten to know over the years doing similar work in other companies, particularly where things had gone wrong, at Yahoo, The Gap, Coca-Cola. And I realized that we face so many common challenges and frustrations, and that our story needed to be told. Because I also got really frustrated with the public conversation after every corporate disaster. Oh great, another evil company full of greedy and evil people. Which isn't true. And also leads us towards solutions that are just about getting the bad guys. There is a global invisible army of corporate idealists like me, working deep inside big companies every day, trying to prevent some of the very disasters that ended up ensuing. They're trying to find that sweet spot where the interests of business and the interests of society align. We have to reframe the conversation and focus on them. We have to understand why did they fail and what they need in order to succeed. So here are some of the themes that emerged from those conversations. One is no one gets rewarded for what doesn't happen. A lot of corporate safety and ethics work is about preventing bad things from happening. And, you know, that's hard to reward for. One supply chain manager who I talked to, who works for a big multinational, told me how one of her colleagues won one of the company's internal awards for managing a big safety disaster. And she was livid. She was like, are you kidding me? I prevented like 20 of those. But it's hard to reward for that. Second theme is that few executives bear witness to the impacts of their decisions on people and communities at the far ends of their supply chain, which makes it easier to do things that hurt them. The International Labor Standards team at Disney arranged for Disney CFO to go visit factories in China where Disney-branded products were made. They saw some good factories, and they saw some not-so-nice ones. And that trip has helped the team continue to gain support for their work. Third theme, people lie. More than one person told me a story of visiting a factory and then doubling back saying they dropped their notebook and seeing all the workers turning in their goggles or their face masks so that they could be kept nice and clean in a box. Factory owners lie, not because they're evil, not because they like exploiting people, but because they think that failing one audit means losing business. Some brands are moving towards longer-term relationships with suppliers to try to change that behavior, but in the meantime, people lie. Okay, those three themes are kind of a bummer, but it wasn't all negative. A former Gap employee told me about visiting suppliers in India. And at the end of a long day, the guy showing him around said, "I want to take you to one more that's not on your list. It supplies the domestic market." And he said they walked into this residential high-rise, walked up a few stories into this room, and it was filthy. There was a kid working one of the machines. And I asked him, "How did you feel when you saw that?" And he said, "Actually, it was one of the moments where I felt like all the work that we're doing is making a difference. Because if the factories we source from today look like that 20 years ago, we have made progress." And that, for me, was the real punchline, was this theme of incrementalism, of knowing that we are working on the toughest issues at the heart of globalization that no one person or team or company can solve overnight. But we are moving business in the right direction. I obviously did not manage to transform all of BP. I obviously didn't even get to know all of BP. But I know I made a difference to those workers and those communities around the projects that I did work on, which is tens of thousands of people, if not more. And that's not bad, though I know it's not good enough. The poet W.H. Auden wrote, "There is a great deal of difference between believing something still and believing it again." Having had my heart broken by big oil, I have come back around to believing that business can be a force for good in the world, but I know that's not going to happen by accident. Companies have to reward prevention, remove incentives to lie and bear witness, and the rest of us have to reward the behavior that we want to see and recognize that there is a community of corporate idealists out there who need our attention and support. We all need them to succeed. I am no longer that girl who fell in love with big oil 15 years ago, but I am a corporate idealist. Thank you.